Welcome to Highbury, gang, where they're not actually allowing us on the pitch, and fair enough. So look, we brought our own. Because this week's show begins in 1981, when this stuff, artificial turf, was going to be the future of football, at least according to Terry Venables. The world had just witnessed the marriage of Charles and Diana. That was supposed to last forever as well. And elsewhere in the game, they introduced 3 points for a win. 3 points! Where would it all end? Well, appropriately, under the 1981 summer heat, this season was to end in Spain and another World Cup. England's eventual World Cup place looked increasingly unlikely, particularly after a notorious defeat at the hands of the then minnows, Norway. England's team that day was a controversial one, including first caps for
Sir Winston Churchill, Henry Cooper, Lady Diana, Maggie Thatcher. You boys took a hell of a beating.
Back on this sceptred isle, the 1981-82 season opened with new champions, Aston Villa, who now prepared for the European Cup with a spring-loaded Ron Saunders leading the way. Liverpool were the European champions once again, but things were changing at Anfield. Among the new faces, a weirdo Zimbabwean called Bruce Grobbelaar.
Clapped over hit that, but Van Merlo chasing all the way, and the rather eccentric skills of Grobbelaar perfectly demonstrated.
Grobbelaar replaced the legendary Ray Clements, who went to Cup winners Tottenham, now becoming serious championship contenders themselves. Yeah, Tottenham. And Ray immediately won the hearts of Spurs fans in the Charity Shield against Villa.
And as the teams come out to raise the curtain on this new season, the signs are that the extra two-week break has sharpened the appetite of supporters, because Wembley looks pretty full. Ray Clements didn't make the cross, and Villa's player of the year last season, Big Peter Whyth, puts them in front. Ardiles, Archibald, Ardiles, Falco, good play, oh what a great goal by Mark Falco. And Hoddle to Galvin. Falco scores again! Well, what a match he's having. Spurs fans celebrate once more. Well played by Colin Gibson. It's going to come to Tony Morley. And there's Whyth coming in. And that's gone in. And again, the cross beats Ray Clements. And again, Peter Whyth puts the ball in the net.
As opening day approached, the hottest ticket in town, well, in Wales, was to see John Toshack's Swansea City make their first division debut after rising like a rocket from the fourth to the first in just 5 seasons.
I don't like champagne. I don't smoke cigars. I haven't any real jewellery at all, you know, apart from the 8 pieces of gold I picked up at Anfield.
A capacity crowd of 23,000 will see these Swansea City players set out to prove against Leeds United tomorrow that they're in the First Division to stay.
It was one of Toshack's big-name signings, Bob Latcham from Everton, who settled the nerves and got Swansea's season off to a real flyer.
Chance for a goal, oh, what a goal! What a goal for Bob Latcham! What a goal, what a shot! James there again. Leighton James. Robinson. Across the face, and it was Latchford with another goal for Swansea City. Leighton James again. On the ball. On the set piece. Latchford's header, it's a goal! So easy!
Another team enjoying a golden year, Ipswich Town. They'd triumphed in Europe and had come so close to a League and Cup double the previous season. They also boasted the Footballer of the Year in Dutchman Frans Tyson. Tyson and the equally feared Arnold Muren were in peak form as Ipswich travelled to Old Trafford to take on Rod Atkinson's Man United.
Muren looking up to see Alan Brazil going through. And a fine ball to him by Muren, and Brazil is in here and he scores. So simple, Alan Brazil, the scorer.
and Arnold Muren made it possible.
Beckham,
that's one for Stapleton to chase, and he got there and he scored his first goal in the league for Manchester United, Frank Stapleton. That's awkward, and that's a chance, and it's gone in. And Johnny Walk is the scorer, having just been deprived of a goal by Lou Macari. He scores from the resulting corner.
It was a stuttering start by United, with a lot of speculation about players Big Ron wanted to bring to Old Trafford, like his former West Brom protégé, Brian Robson.
Robbo had made it known that he wanted to come with me. In fact, when I got the job, he rang me from an England trip and said, you know, don't forget me. So, I burst out laughing about that with him. I said, you behave yourself, Robbo, and we'll see what happens.
What happened was a record 1.5 million changed hands, and bubble-headed Robbo was all comb over Ron's.
Not even a gamble, you know, find a player like him, because he's pure gold.
United fans first saw Robson during a rather eggy on-pitch pretend signing thing.
It was a bit embarrassing as well. I was wondering really what I was doing being signed there, because United went on to beat Wolves 5-0, and Sammy McElroy, who everybody had said I was supposed to be going to replace, scored a hat-trick that day.
There was a minute's silence before Liverpool's league game against Swansea. During this, John Toshek's own tribute was sadly misread by some as a bid for the manager's seat.
Before a minute's silence, I think Toshek took off his Swansea top and revealed a Liverpool strip, which I thought nothing of at the time, but I understand later it didn't go down too well with some of the people who mattered at Anfield.
To have had such success there and to have gone back there so soon after leaving for Swansea was a big day for me, and I think any Liverpool player who's played at Anfield and who's left and has gone back there would tell you the same thing.
The Toshek shirt incident, plus some inevitable crass whistling during the minute's silence, combined to produce a tense atmosphere which made for a bad-tempered game.
Ball picked up by Mahoney, that's a good ball through to Latchford. And a fine piece of goalkeeping by Grobbelaar. Oh, what is that? It should be a penalty. And a goal. A beautiful goal. Nicely slotted. Nice turn by Robbie James. Neil Robinson backing him up on the right. Thompson, and it could drop nicely for Latchford, and he makes it pay. McDermott, good ball. Dalglish across the face, Whelan, he did well. Penalty. McDermott, the man to take it. Davis almost got there. Neil. Oh, that's a fine ball and bad positioning by Hansi Adbic. Good cross. Dalglish is there. Di Davis. Good. And taking out McDermott, and a penalty to Liverpool again.
Furious keeper Di Davis insists he did not take out Terry McDermott. To illustrate this, he will shortly really take out Terry McDermott. Fortunately, Graham Souness is on hand to provide his customary corrective therapy.
We're on our way. We are Ron's 22.
Now, this mournful song is actually in celebration of England's qualification for the World Cup finals. A Wembley win over Hungary secures their ticket to Spain.
Holding Martin up with the goalkeeper, this is Trevor Brooking. Oh, there's a chance there, it's a goal! Paul Mariner!
Scotland too reached the finals with a lot of help from soon-to-be TV star Andy Gray. Here he wins a ludicrous penalty against Sweden, for which he looks rightfully ashamed. Even the ref says, ah, what you gonna do? Without a shred of conscience, John Robertson converts the gift and the Scots are on their way.
Fantastic! Stop here, stop here. That's that. Great! Oh, you did fantastic. Well, thanks for
stopping, pal. Hey, I'll just get my luggage.
We're on our
way to
welcome. Hey, what's
happening? Our weekly dose of little and large. Billy Bingham's Northern Ireland make it a hat-trick of home teams to qualify for the World Cup finals, and that's the first time it's happened since Sweden in 1958. Meantime, back at White Hart Lane, Tottenham, with all their endearing Cockney Roots supporters, show they are ready to embrace the much-talked-of flotation. Brian Robson and Man United would be the latest visitors.
Huddle has ever to take. And it was Roberts' header. Why Duxbury headed it, I don't know, neither I imagine would he. And it ends up with a goal scored by Hazard. Archibald in the six-yard box, Roberts behind it. Oh, he might get a free header! Wilkins takes the kick. Here's Bertels. And he got it at the second time. Archibald. Oh, good try! And what a lovely goal!
Meanwhile, across North London, Arsenal boss Terry Neill was feeling the heat following a series of poor results and the controversial transfers of Highbury heroes Liam Brady and Frank Stapleton. With Brady now in Italy and Stapleton installed at Man United, the Arsenal fans are as mad as hell and not going to take any more.
There's been terrible mismanagement, otherwise Arsenal wouldn't be in this situation, and somebody somewhere should definitely take the rap for that.
Who can I replace Frank Stapleton with? Who is better than Liam Brady in Europe?
He's not prepared to give backhanders like the rest of the managers in the league.
Wouldn't you accept that explanation?
No! If you can't get the players and that's what you've got to do, that's what you've got to do!
I'm sure that you've got to play by the book. And it's courting disaster to do anything that is not legal. And we're not prepared to get involved in it.
So there never has been and never will be any bungs at Arsenal. Oh, and they're all teetotal too. Off they go to West Ham.
Phil Parks came for it, it's White with a chance and he scored! For Chris White, that's his first goal in league football. No wonder he's so pleased, and those fans are too. Sansom. Tackle was by Ray Stewart, the linesman is flagging. And a penalty, which John Hollins will take, and a chance for Arsenal to go 2-up. And they do. John Hollins, since his Chelsea days, always a very reliable striker of the dead ball.
Following mass cancellations due to poor weather, artificial turf is pitched as an alternative. And it's QPR's Terry Venables leading the way to puff this amazing new wonder turf.
If you actually, I came to you and I was going to try and sell you a grass pitch and everyone had Omni Turf, I would say to you, well, I've got this new idea of a grass pitch, and you say, what, grass all the year round? I say, no, not all the year round, but for 2 months it's very nice, it's good. And then we get a bit heavy in the goal mouths and the goalkeepers can't move so well. And then when the rain comes really hard, we get rain all over. Now, the ball don't bounce at all. It goes and it sticks in the mud. It don't bounce at all.
Goes Stonehouse. See how quickly the ball came off the surface there. Well judged by John Burridge. But when the ball bounces, there's a matter of judgment.
And as it turned out, whenever a player bounced on it, there was a matter of first-degree burns. Still, BBC consumer expert Bob Wilson was sent out to investigate.
Reading the bounce of a downward header is equally difficult, as I'm sure Barnsley's Robbie Horn would be quick to testify.
He went down low for a header that looked as though it was going to shoot through, and it bounced over the top. Any footballer would probably rather play on this than some of the 6-inch deep mud heaps and the icy, frosty grounds that we play on sometimes.
That was like concrete. It was actually an awful pitch.
Subutio pitches. The only difference being that in Subutio, when the man goes down, he rolls up and gets up.
Well, the goalkeepers used to pass it to each other. Well, then that was it.
Plastic wasn't the best. It wasn't to play football on. That's for playing hockey or whatever, isn't it?
It was a certain amount of what I would call ping-pong football being played.
Ping-pong football, what's that?
Great deal of ball bouncing around and players trying to get it under control.
Oh, well, balls do bounce, or most balls bounce. but at the same time, I think that the ball's got to be controlled.
If you've got a good touch in the ball and a good skill factor, then plastic pitches are never a problem to you.
Oh, what a good piece of skill.
We had an advantage of training on it all week and then playing on it, and in a way, it was a different game.
Look, the Christmas league table shows Swansea leading the field. Man United and Ipswich are close, but Liverpool, nowhere.
For visiting players, the famous Anfield sign used to mean abandon hope. But these days, a home defeat for Liverpool no longer makes the headlines. This week, Bob Paisley had to actually appeal for Liverpool fans to give their team more support.
We got off to not the best start in the world, and at Christmas we had an absolutely torrid time. I remember one game against Manchester City at Anfield where they beat us 3-1 and could have been 5 or 6, and Bruce was coming and missing. And it looked at that stage and that it was the end of an era, people were calling it.
Horrigan's kick is stretching Thompson. To Reeves, and Thompson gets it clear. Grobbelaar goes up and drops it again, and that's a penalty. Thompson turning it over, Grobbelaar made the mistake, Kinsey fired to the top corner of the net, and Thompson had no option but to do what his goalkeeper perhaps should have done in the first place and make a decent save. So City could go ahead here. And do. And a fine ball. There's Kinsey. Francis screaming for it on the edge of the box. Reeves with a back flick, and it's gone in! And Grobbelaar's misery is complete. Reeves gets the goal, but really, it was almost an own goal by this sad figure of Bruce Grobbelaar. Much of Liverpool's form was put down to Grobbelaar's shaky start, dubbed clown by Everton supporters after a typically individual display. Indeed, it was a priceless moment of bonkers Brucey, which led to Liverpool's shock exit from the European Cup.
Oh, and that one came off Mike Lyon's head. It was hooked out by Mark Lawrenson. Grobbelaar's having a dicey period.
Didn't help the team at all, really. But then again, it's a 12-man team. And, you know, maybe everybody wasn't pushing together. I think it's the fans that you've got to please, because they pay your wages.
But for each yin, there's a yang, and often the spectacular was pulled off.
Bruce was taking a lot of the blame for a lot of the defeats, but he's big enough and manly enough to take it on the chin when it was happening. And as he proved in later years, he was probably one of the finest keepers Liverpool ever had.
Whilst Liverpool struggle for form, in the lower divisions, clubs are struggling for their very survival. Falling attendances at Bristol City aren't helped by a visit from the receivers or by the decision to sack 8 senior players, the Ashton Gate 8 they became known, all in a bid to save a few quid. A few of the desperate clubs were lucky enough to find millionaires to bail them out. Oxford found their future secured via Robert Maxwell. Hooray! That's him in the wig.
The handshakes were sincere. Maxwell's kept these men in a job and saved the football club from dying.
Having made a few shillings and accepting that there are public responsibilities of a person like myself, I felt I must not allow this club to go under.
Back at the top of the top table, there's a cracking first v second place fixture unfolding as Swansea welcome Manchester United to the Vetch Field.
Flag stays down, and here's Curtis. And it went, I think, through Bailey's legs.
as he was going back. Leighton James, dear, what a wild challenge from Wilkins.
Biscott was hilarious.
And Bailey, and yes, no on the line, but put in by Robbie James. Bailey with the hand, Latchford with the shot, Robbie James with the follow-in.
They were good days at the Vetch. We had big crowds, and the crowds came to the game thinking that we were going to beat these top sides. And I think that was, there was a very positive attitude about the club in those days, and I think that was one of the big reasons, you know, for the success that we were having.
Ipswich were keeping tabs with the leaders despite a chronic injury crisis, which at one stage cost them 7 first-team players. The stress of this caused Alan Brazil to try to grow his own shirt. But they crawled off the fitness table and made their way to Highfield Road, Coventry.
Urin's corner then. Butcher's header again. What a superb goal. And once again, John Ward's ability to arrive in situations like that has paid off. Oh, that's fine skill by Brazil. A dangerous cross as well. Still Brazil. Thomas, he was who got it clear, but here's Gates. And now Muren. Fine goal by the Dutchman. Early to Mills. A lot of players in the middle for him. Gates! Great save. Mariner gets the rebound in. So unlucky though, Blythe. Gates. Brazil want to get played forward. Oh, and it's broken for him off Gillespie. Has he the calmness to control it? He has indeed. A superb goal by Alan Brazil.
The shock of the season comes when smiling Ron Saunders resigns from champions Aston Villa.
And he just said that he'd had enough. You know, he just felt that he wasn't being left to manage the team as a manager should be, and he ended up, he decided to leave, which was a big shock.
And all the more shocking since Villa were going well, struggling a bit in the league maybe, but on a run in the European Cup.
Still Shaw, oh, he's done so well here. And it's in! Gary Shaw, a superb goal!
Tony Barton, that's Tony Barton, was the surprise choice to replace Saunders as Villa boss. His promotion from club scout was well received by the players as they shaped up to Belgian champions Anderlecht in the European Cup semi-final.
1-0!
Villa's single goal proved enough in the return leg in Belgium, but the result was called into doubt following outbreaks of violence between the rival fans, which almost cost Villa their place in the final. In the event, Villa escaped with a hefty fine. Also in Europe, Barcelona came to White Hart Lane in the Cup Winners' Cup quarter-final, with Dutch referee Egbert Mulder in the thick of things.
Oh, foul by number 10, Estella, yellow card. Oh, look at that. And the red card for Estella.
It was a tough game, it always is against Barcelona, and they just kick lumps out of us, basically.
Look at Garth having a go there. And just when Spurs thought things couldn't get any worse, they got any worse.
Olmo! Oh! What an error by Ray Clements! Disaster! You wouldn't wish that on a goalkeeper at any time, at any level of football, and it's happened to one of the best in the world.
Battered by Barcelona, Spurs were then licked by Liverpool in the all-new Milk Cup as sponsorship fever broke out.
Football sponsorship is surely getting out of hand. I mean, soon it'll be the Blancmange Charity Shield. Or Roundtree sponsoring the cup final with the sweet FA Cup.
Despite crap cup form elsewhere, Spurs were heading for a second consecutive FA final appearance, dumping Chelsea along the way.
Hughton for Tottenham. Archibald, little flick for Hazard. Hoddle moving up on the right. Hoddle's shot. Oh! What a goal!
Having threatened to withdraw from the competition over their precious plastic pitch, QPR are also on a cup run and face West Brom in the Highbury semi-final.
And Hazel!
all this week they've been saying, well, you can't play on grass, can you? You know, and I thought we had something to prove, and we proved it, I think.
Liverpool by now have turned things around under the leadership of their new captain, Graham Souness, and his top tash. They're back in business, even show business.
You're Graham Souness, aren't you? Yeah. I'm Yossi Hughes.
Pleased to meet you.
You look like me.
Oh, aye.
Magnum as well.
And I'm just sitting, talking and making small chat, and then when the light's gone and you're asked to do it, and he's right in your face, I'm thinking, has he lost it here? Does he mean this? Because he was right in my face.
Meanwhile, on football stage, the season has entered its last quarter, and Liverpool, being Liverpool, have decided that, well, they do fancy the championship after all.
Souness, and again from Rush, that's beautifully done, and so is the finish. Hansen swung in towards Rush and a very good ball too. Oh, that's superb finishing by Ian Rush.
Man United have fallen away, Aston Villa have fallen away. Why, even Swansea have fallen away. So it's up to Bobby Robson's Ipswich to make a title race of it. Here, Middlesbrough come to Portman Road.
Gates on the ball now. Oh, and Brazil did well to reach that. There's Ward! It's Muren. It's there. He can curl them, can't he? So, so simple. And they've got four waiting for Muren's cross. And that's Walk. And that's Baxter. And that's Gates. And that is Brazil. Who says thank you very much. And the crowd are relieved.
For the second year running, the Championship goes to the final Saturday. Ipswich must beat Nottingham Forest and hope that Tottenham can hold or beat Liverpool at Anfield. Now that would take something pretty special.
Hoddle. And Hoddle strikes one. Oh, a beautiful goal. Glenn Hoddle puts Spurs in front.
So, with Liverpool trailing to Glenn Hoddle's blistering thump, Ipswich are in with a chance. But Brian Clough's Nottingham Forest won't be pushed over.
It's a good turn if he can get the shot in now. And it's going in! Reba. And here's Davenport again. Oh, I say, what a good finish. And that surely is the end of Ipswich Town's outside chance of winning the title.
Last 2 years, we lost the championship on the last day, on the last 90 minutes of the season.
Back at Anfield, Ray Clements is reunited with the Kop before second-half hostilities commence.
In comes Lawrenson! Dalglish. Pinch up there. Oh, Dalglish is through. Kenny Dalglish. Clements had no chance at all. Miller's header. It's going to come to Whelan. And Whelan makes it 3-1. The championship now.
Having let everyone else dream for over half the season, Liverpool ran in undefeated in their last 16 games. That rotten start, just a memory, a tease. They were champs now, no danger.
Every time we played on a Saturday at the end of the season to win the championship, we won it. 89 was a Friday night, and that was the difference. If it had been a Saturday, we would have beaten Arsenal. 89 was a Friday night.
We'll be right back.
Good evening. Preparations for a possible war with Argentina continue today.
I'm not allowed to say how many planes joined the raid, but I counted them all out and I counted them all back.
The Falklands crisis threatens to end Ozzie Ardiles and Ricky Villa's plans of a second FA Cup final appearance. Ozzie did play in the semi-final against Leicester after the war had broken out, but was roundly booed every time he touched the ball. Soon he'd had enough of that and was going home.
It is, I can say, a crazy war between two countries that could be very, very good friends.
He finally returned to Buenos Aires and World Cup duty, receiving a hero's welcome for coming home. Ricky Villa, meantime, stayed put and, bunging on an England shirt, hoped for the best.
In that week before the cup final, it was a big dilemma for me. Should I play him or shouldn't I play him? And I let gut instinct take over and I thought, no, we can't do that. It's not going to be fair to him because there's going to be a lot of controversy at Wembley that day.
No Ardiles or Villa then, as Spurs and QPR buckle down to business.
Oh, good tackle by Hoddle on Waddick. Roberts. Hoddle. Hoddle! It's there! It's there! He won it with the tackle and he scored the goal. Glenn Hoddle, the pride of Tottenham, has sent the fans delirious again. Well, it's almost like winter now, the way the rain's coming down. The afternoon has turned in more ways than one. Steinrod with the long throw for Queen's Park Rangers. Roberts, it was Hazel's flick, and Fenwick was in there, and it's a goal. Terry Fenwick.
The cup final went to a replay for the second year running. Unfortunately for Rangers, their star striker Clive Allen was sidelined and had to make do with a case of suck it and see.
Roberts. Away from John Gregory, Graham Roberts. Archibald to his right, he overran it but still got through. This is Graham Roberts. Was he brought down? Penalty. Tony Curry came in behind him, but a penalty has been given and it was a splendid run by Graham Roberts. Terry Venables' side couldn't stop him. Bob Hazel made an error in that early on, but Roberts went on. And what happens here? Tony Curry comes in with the tackle. Down he goes. Penalty. Hoddle to take. Scores.
That game wasn't a classic. It wasn't like the Man City game in 81. It was just the way we'd played all season. We definitely deserved to win a trophy because of some of the football was breathtaking.
The end of a very long Tottenham season. But that's what came at the end.
Meanwhile, Aston Villa were playing the biggest game in the club's history, their European Cup final against German champions Bayern Munich. They got off to a troubled start when Villa's experienced keeper Jimmy Rimmer gave way to novice reserve Nigel Spink.
Oh, this could be trouble now. Dernberger shot.
Encouraged by Spink's heroic,
Peter Wint's goal has brought the European Cup to England again.
And what a magnificent trophy that is. I mean, it's one of the greatest trophies, I think, that you could ever pick up in football. It's just the dream come true that you've got your hands on the European Cup.
Villa have done it.
With domestic and European issues decided, there was just the small matter of the World Cup finals in Spain. The English, the Scots and the Irish were all present, but it was the England team that got off to an instant flyer.
Already the French marking up, man for man, Mariner's on the near post, Butcher has pushed well forward, there's a header in there, and a great chance for the first goal, and it's there, Brian Robson! It's Francis, and Robson!
second of the match.
Not to be outdone, the Scots had beaten New Zealand, but had in turn been well spanked by Brazil. And now only victory would be good enough against a very strong Russian team.
Miller. And the two of them get in each other's way. And this is Shengelia to put Scotland out of the World Cup.
The real surprise in Spain were the Irish, who produced the result of the tournament when up against the hosts.
Still Billy Hamilton, he's got past Tendilio. And Armstrong! Northern Ireland have scored through Jerry Armstrong!
The Irish team came home to a hero's welcome, while England turned to its injured stars in the desperate hunt for a couple of goals. England were unbeaten, but out. Picking itself up, the World Cup somehow bravely went on without us. You know, but if you speak to anyone about the 1982 World Cup, it didn't really register. Spain, the World Cup that never was. And how was British football going to pick itself up after such a disjointed and disappointing summer? Well, the answer in part lay with that man, Brian Robson, who was on the verge of the golden period of his career. And British football itself, it didn't know what far-reaching changes were just around the corner. It didn't include this stuff, thankfully. Although it's good for something.
An album that changed the face of rock music. Next here on BBC One, the making of Paul Simon's Graceland. Then we'll fly the flag.